Oh, there's sudden certain death.
Speed, pure adrenaline.
And then I almost killed the duck.
Hello and welcome to Whitchurch in Shropshire. To be precise, Whitchurch Railway Station, which is not, you might think, the most obvious place to start a canal boating video. But I'm here to act in my capacity as taxi driver for two, well, they can only be described as superstar American vloggers. They started out many years ago in an RV touring around America, and then they sold that, bought a boat and went round much of the world. Well, now they're having a brand new boat being built, and while that happens, they thought they might like to try narrowboating. So I've sorted them out 10 days on what is probably Britain's most popular canal, the Llangollen. And their train, bringing them up from Gatwick Airport, should be here any moment. And here it comes, just a funny little single carriage train coming down, rather aptly, from Crewe. With all other passengers off and away, there were just two lost souls at the foot of the steps.
Guess who it is?
Oh, great!
It's flipping Nikki and Jason Wynn. You've gone with the Wynns.
You get to see this mess. This is everything we own, David.
Hurry it up. Come on. What do you think you're doing? Have you brought enough for a week?
It's only our entire lives in these bags. No big deal.
I'd help, but I'm filming.
Yeah, that's what I say all the time.
The first thing we needed to do, of course, was provision the boat, as the Llangollen Canal is quite rural, so supermarkets are rare along its length. Happily, there's a decent-sized Tesco right next to the canal basin where the boat was being hired from.
Oh, you are doing well.
We are.
Look at that.
I keep telling myself, I'm like, it's only 10 days, yeah. But...
It's 10 days in the middle of nowhere.
Yeah. Pretty much 10 days of only eating on the boat, I think. I hope. If I'm going overboard, David, it all goes to you.
Hooray! <Yeah.
laughs> Then we took the haul to the marina.
Well, here you are.
I know. Ah.
How do you feel?
Sun.
I'm actually quite excited now that I can see all the little narrow boats.
So cute, all the trees with the flowers.
I know.
Beautiful. Yeah.
I'm having a hard time wanting to look at you because all the boats are this way.
The first order of business was to check in.
Hi.
You guys arrived.
Yes. We are here to pick up a Swift.
Exactly.
Conversation ensued about general boaty stuff and the handover procedure.
It won't be too much longer, so I think they're just checking it off. So you've got plenty of time to go up there because some boats doing it 3 to 4 night break.
The canal map and guidebook was inspected and found to be full of promise.
Yep. I just want to go
big
here.
Big highlights, yeah.
You just want to go, oh, absolutely, you can go there.
Okay. And the green grass?
We can order that, right?
Yeah.
Can we get ducks and swans along the way as well?
On the canal.
The hire boat fleet had been returned that morning by previous holiday makers, so while the boats were cleaned, restocked with linen and generally turned around, Nikki and Jason took the opportunity to get some aerial shots of the location.
This is a new drone.
No.
Then, with the boat ready, it was time to go aboard for their first look at their home for the next 10 days. And some filming, of course, which I didn't realise was going to involve me.
Because we have the arguably, the canal boating expert.
The canal king.
The canal king. We'll call him the canal king. This is David from Cruising the Cut.
Just tell me how you're feeling right now. What's the feeling of anticipation?
Oh, speed, pure adrenaline.
The opposite of that. No, I'm super excited. Just the boats are so stinking cute. I'm just excited. I don't even know what to say at the moment, actually.
I'm looking forward to a warm cup of tea because it's quite chilly.
It is. Well, we're chugging along the canal. And whopping 3 knots.
I think my favorite part's going to be whenever I get off the boat and run faster than the boat. I think that's going to be a great clip. Yeah. I'll probably walk faster than the boat. Maybe I should rephrase that.
It was time to lock and load.
See,
This is David. Like, oh, I have to film. I can't help. I can't help.
Harsh and unfair. I did actually help, and their luggage was, I swear, full of lead bricks. At least it felt like that.
And the narrowness and the tight squeezes starts already.
Yeah. Welcome to narrowboating.
That's right.
It's called that for a reason.
Before we set off, I did a quick tour. This is the back deck, a so-called cruiser stern. Going inside, you first see the kitchen. Sailing terms like galley just aren't really used in narrowboats. Beyond that is a combined saloon and dinette. And yes, for any new American viewers, we do call it a saloon, not salon. A salon is where you get your hair cut or your nails painted. The bathroom follows with toilet, sink and shower. And the final room at the bow of this 49-foot boat is the bedroom. There is central heating for any chilly nights. Narrowboats are a standard 6 feet 10 inches wide for historic reasons, the British canals dating back to the mid-1700s.
It's such a long, narrow boat that is thinking what corners and how do you turn and getting out of here. I am very interested to see how this is all going to pan out.
This is breaking news. We have a long, narrow boat in the canal.
And this is the canal they'll be turning out onto, the Llangollen, which runs for 46 miles from Hurlston in England to Llangollen itself in North Wales. But when you hire a narrowboat, you're not just given the keys and let loose. There's a full handover procedure, where every aspect of the boat is shown and demonstrated by friendly folk like this chap.
Come to tie this in up the boats.
Starting at the back, Nikki and Jason were told everything about running the engine, mooring up, and inspecting the propeller through the weed hatch. On reflection, it really is a lot for people to take in, especially if they've never narrowboated, or indeed never boated at all.
Yep, that's it, you open up the hose pipe on end.
Easy.
And when it's full, on this side, just in there.
There are few locks on the Llangollen, but you need to know how to operate them, as they're all done by hand by the boaters, so this model shows the way they work. Inside, there were warnings of some possible hazards to be aware of. Then it was time to be taken out on the boat for a handling tutorial. Given the compact dimensions of the marina basin, the tight entrance and the lack of space on the canal, steering the boat off the mooring and out of the marina was left to the expert. He pivoted the narrowboat neatly on its bow until it was pointing towards the canal. There's no bow thruster on these, though it can be handy, it's really not necessary. Since you can't see, the horn lets people know you're coming out. And no sooner had we exited than Jason was handed the tiller, adopting a braced poise ready for anything.
Tomorrow, just turn in.
Look at the expression of solid and utter concentration on his face. That's because immediately he had to steer us through a bridge hole. It's barely wider than the boat.
Oh my gosh!
When you've never done it before, it's quite the challenge.
Because the boat's pivoting in the middle.
Yeah.
You've always got to remember what the back end does.
No surprise that Jason did it perfectly, but you could sense the sweat gathering on his brow.
Man.
You made it through and you didn't kill anybody. Good job.
Holy cow, my heart's racing. It's like, man, I did not expect that. Okay, off to a good start, guys. Thanks.
Yeah.
It's gonna be exciting.
Yeah.
This will not be boring. I don't know what you were thinking. Although I'll report back in 10 days.
The next challenge was a 90-degree turn to the left, with some moored boats to avoid. There's lots of space, and Jason had clearly got the hang of it already. though narrowboats do steer like oil tankers, slowly and with momentum. Past the Canal and River Trust facilities point, where you can top up your water tank and dispose of your litter, all paid for by the annual license fee that canal boaters pay. Here's an historic working boat that I did a video about recently. I've put a link to that in the video description.
So this one here, Saturn, yep. she's a special boat?
Yeah, shrubby fly boat, or four-storm boat. Great.
Once past the boats, Jason had a quick test of how to come to a stop.
Just a small bit of throttle.
Right, just a small bit of throttle.
Yeah. If you notice the boat going off. Yeah.
And the tutor stepped off to demonstrate how to moor against the towpath.
Still reverse?
No, that's it. Okay. That is a perfect mooring.
Mooring is straightforward enough. Ropes tied at the front and back, or lines at the bow and stern if you really want nautical jargon. In most places, there's nothing to tie to, so you either bang pins into the ground or drop hooks around the metal edging of the canal.
So you pull it up, okay. So you do that.
Then our intrepid explorers just needed to sign some forms, and off we could go.
We understand we are in danger. Yeah.
With the tutor walking back to the marina, it was up to Jason to set sail. One strict message that had been drummed in was to go very slowly past moored boats. I had worried that narrowboating would be a bit tame for seasoned ocean-crossing sailors, but apparently not.
This is way more exciting than I ever thought this was going to be, and we've just gotten off maybe like, what, a couple hundred meters? It's tight in here.
Yeah. Uh-oh.
Time for Nikki to take the reins.
I'll get you on the straightaway.
Okay.
He did say that doing it like shorter
is better.
Is better.
Okay.
Like constant, yeah. Unless you really need it for a big one.
Okay.
Okay. Okay, ready?
Okay.
All you.
The double camera action isn't making me feel nervous at all. I wish you could have my view.
We seemed, alarmingly, to be heading for the bank, but everything was under control.
Wanting to get a feel for it.
Yeah.
Is that what it was?
Yes! I'm like, how hard does it turn?
The pastoral countryside scenes were exactly what Jason had hoped for, as he was keen to cuddle a lamb, he told me. I made a nuisance of myself by interviewing Nikki, just as she concentrated on her first proper bend in the canal.
How are you feeling about steering?
It's like steering a narrowboat, like a massive piece of steel down a little river. It's quite novel, really.
Thinking they'd likely had enough of me by now, I went up front to get some shots and give them some peace. Though that didn't stop me filming from a distance.
See, that's a pretty hard turn.
Yeah.
So again, you just can't see people.
Yeah. No. And you can tell there's a lot of wind up there, too.
Mm-hmm. Water.
In glorious tandem, the pair instinctively went for the old lean-out approach to looking ahead.
See anybody?
No.
This would be Nikki's first bridge hole approach. It's quite usual not to be able to see if anything's coming the other way. You just have to proceed with caution. Once you get close, visibility usually improves. past like a pro.
That was a little S-curve there.
Yeah.
For my big hunk of steel.
So that's what she calls him. With it getting late in the day, the Wynns needed to moor for the night, and I needed to head off elsewhere. So Nikki steered the boat to the bank and held the boat on the centerline while Jason took on securing the bow.
I'll act as a
pin. Yeah. That is not right. That's right. What are the chances I'm going to lose these?
Oh, quite high.
Okay, good.
With the rear also secured, it was time to reflect on a busy day.
Your first journey, how do you feel?
Easy peasy, man. This is going to be a cakewalk. Flashback to the shot 10 minutes of me going, oh!
No, it is. It's very exciting. And I have to say that, you know, it's nice. I can't imagine if they just gave you the training and then said, see you later. But the fact that they actually come out here and you kind of do your first little bit together, it does, makes me feel a lot better. Yeah, so I'm kind of like, all right, let's go. I'm excited now. I'm ready for like, yes, a nice little, you know, chill evening here with David. And then we'll set off in the morning and it'll just proper little English adventure.
I said my goodbyes and left them to their vacation, which in highlight form looks like this.
Talk about a tight squeeze. Just a watery elevator.
We have a selection of British biscuits. Okay, ready?
No. Right here.
Yeah.
Oh, it's starting to form like stalagmites or stalactites.
Yeah.
Here's our boat, and yeah.
Everything I ever expected, and more. That was awesome.
A hop and skip away from the marina, on a popular visitor mooring arm near the supermarket, the Wynns had moored for the weekend. I went in to find them having a familiar discussion.
This thing doesn't have a dishwasher.
He's never going to let it go.
Let's not start that again. Oh, well, Nikki, you did lose.
If we're going by audience poll, I lost by like a long shot. I'm pretty sure it was 95 to maybe 5% on my side.
Oh, man.
Last time I polled the audience.
So, for the final time, the key gets ready.
Oh, yeah.
And after their hibernation, they emerge.
We emerge, yes.
Blinking into the daylight.
Jason cast off the bow lines and pushed off. The boat began its final return with Nikki at the tiller.
Move it, build it. I almost hit the stop engine button.
How had their experience been?
Oh, I've had an absolutely delightful time. So much more than I kind of anticipated, I think. I mean, I always thought it would be fun, but it was more fun than I expected, more exciting than I expected, just because of the locks and...
Wow, jeez, and David was like, you're gonna be bored, it's nothing like sailing, you're gonna be so bored. No, it was like exciting every turn. There was something going on, it's just...
Are you just saying this for me?
No! We absolutely were having a delightful time, and the thing is like, we're not used to having so much scenery around. Yeah. So I was so obsessed with like the flowers and the birds.
The baby
and
ducks, we saw the cutest black sheep with a little baby with a little white face. It was like...
Yeah, so no, yeah. That's the thing is, out at sea, it's like, unless we get dolphins or something, that's it, it's just water and waves. And here, there was just constantly so much to kind of take in.
Amazing how much my heart was pumping when we got to like the aqueduct or we got to some of those locks. And I had to run up there and I was all alone. I was like, okay, am I doing it right? It was awesome.
I think it's also because everything goes so slow, right? So it's like slow motion, yeah. So it's like all this excitement, but it's not exactly happening fast. So I think it kind of extends everything a little bit, and also just because it was all new for us.
Yeah.
So I loved it. I'm ready for next trip.
Yeah. What's the most dangerous one? That's where we're going next.
Just two bridges lay between us and the marina, many other hirers also mooring here overnight, ready to return their boats that morning. We turned left, then under Bridge 58, and got ready to pull up outside so the marina staff could bring the narrowboat back in.
Okay, I'll jump off.
Again?
I'll go and jump off.
But even this was high drama.
What have you forgotten?
I forgot the line.
Never mind, we got back in safely and unloaded. Before I took them back to the train station, some final thoughts.
I would say the biggest high was the aqueduct, going across that 127 foot, right over with the edge right there, and it just felt like in a sailboat, you'd be like tied in to your sailboat, but there it was just like, oh, there's sudden certain death right there, like that. Like
one little false step and yeah. Over you go. It's shocking that nobody's ever actually done that.
And no railing like up here to lean on. It's like, oh, you just happened to whoa. Yeah, anyway. And then I almost killed the duck. Yeah, I was in one of the narrow portions and this duck was swimming towards me and I was like, fly out. And sure enough, he decided to swim right next to me. And as soon as he saw me, he started swimming with me the whole way. And I'm like, don't kill the duck. So I slam on the brakes. He eventually swims past me again and then does it all over again. I thought for sure I was going to squash a duck and that would have just, that would have killed me.
I will say the duck's responses are not the most brilliant. They inevitably seem to run towards the danger instead of away from it. So that was a little... Every time there were like baby ducks or anything, you're like, oh, please don't.
That was probably the most stressful.
Yeah.
Yeah. Didn't want to kill a duck.
And no ducks were harmed in the making of this adventure.
Thank goodness. Yeah.
That you know.
That we know.
No.
Nikki and Jason are now about to head off down to Heathrow and catch a flight to China. But while they've been here, I've been trying to introduce them to great British institutions. For example, when we were in a restaurant the other day, I introduced them to brown sauce, which apparently is not something they have in the US. And I thought, what else can we possibly do? Great cultural institutions, the Houses of Parliament, Big Ben. I thought, no, what we need is something else entirely. And that's why I'm taking them to Greg's.
In the parking lot, yeah.
Can we get one vegan sausage roll, please?
Yeah.
And a sticky bun? Sticky bun? The last one.
Glazed ring donut. Thank you.
Famous Greg's.
Right.
Tastes like a pastry soft sausage.
It tastes so
British.
So English.